نحمد ونصلي على رسول الكريم اما بعد اعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم منكم امه يامرون بالمعروف وينهون عن المنكر وقال عليه الصلاه والسلام من راى منكم منكرا فليغير بيده فان لم يستطع بلسانه فان لم يستطع بقلبه وذلك اضعف الايمان او كما قال عليه الصلاه والسلام My dear brothers and sisters, assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi ta'ala wa barakatuh. Today, we want to discuss an issue that is very much in essence with our life. The Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, we all believe as Muslims, was the last prophet. And the doors of prophethood have been closed. From time to time, liars have come up claiming prophethood, na'udhu billah. But it has been proven beyond doubt that after the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, there will be no revelation to a person as a prophet. But we also have to realize that the mission has to continue. Da'wah has to continue. When the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam passed away, there were hardly 200,000 Muslims around. But da'wah befell the followers of this ummah. Now, before we go into da'wah, we have to understand that da'wah is not only the work of the ulama. The ulama can clarify the issues and give you details. But preaching da'wah, tawheed, is the work of every Muslim. When the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam approached Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, and after Abu Bakr became a Muslim, the first question that Abu Bakr put forward to the Prophet, what is my mission? What are my responsibilities? And he said, my mission is your mission. We just woke up and found Islam at our doorstep. We are Muslims by default. Unlike our brothers, Dr. Bilal Phillips, Yusuf Estes, and the rest, these are Muslims by choice. We are Muslims by default. We woke up and found Islam at our doorstep. What have we done to value that Islam? What have we sacrificed for that Islam? Today we are losing Muslim lands to non-Muslims and to munafiqeen. And we are not even feeling the slightest guilt. Why? Because we found Islam for free. We are like a band of thieves who went into a village, stole a very beautiful stallion, expensive stallion. But after stealing the stallion, they did not have any intention of using the stallion. So when they went out of the outskirts of the city, they divided themselves into two. There are those that were left with the stallion, and there are those who went into another city or village to look for a potential buyer. Those left with the stallions, as their friends or co-thieves went to look for potential buyers, so a man approached, very nicely, handsomely dressed. And as he came near them, he asked them, are you selling this stallion? He said, yes. Because of his outlook and appearance, they thought he was a potential buyer. A stallion at that time was like a Pajero or a Prado today. So in other words, these were carjackers. So he said, can I have a test drive? Obviously, if I have to buy something, I have to know. They said, okay, fine. He mounted the stallion and ran away with it. In the evening, the late evening, when the other band came back, they saw their friend standing there because they knew each other. The thieves could not run away. They knew each other. So they thought, oh, the stallion is gone. That means we have got a very good deal. After coming in and exchanging greetings and so forth, they asked, what happened? Did you find a good buyer for the stallion? They said, yes. Said, how much did you sell it for? Said, the same price that we bought it for. We stole from others and it was stolen from us. That is exactly what Islam is today to us. We have found it for free. That's why we don't feel any anger when someone attacks Islam. We take it for granted, and that's why people bring in issues into Islam and we don't even feel the slightest remorse and guilt. Why? Because we found Islam for free. What is Islam to us? Praying 5 times salah, fasting Ramadan, giving sadaqah and zakah. When you can, you go for Hajj. And we think that is Islam. That is not Islam. That is just one branch of Islam, ibadat, acts of worship. The aqidah, we found it for free. Although even in the aqidah these days, there are ups and downs. Like there are those people who have made it a habit of asking you, Aina Allah? Where is Allah? The answer be, kama yaliqu bi sha'nihi. Because if you answer that Allah is everywhere, then na'udhu billah, their small minds will start telling you, so that means Allah is under our feet, na'udhu billah. If you say Allah is everywhere and na'udhu billah, you say is under your feet or is next to you, that means you have given Allah a body. Allah does not have a body. That is shirk. And if you say Allah fi sama, he's in the skies or on his arsh, you have confined Allah to a place. Allah is not confined, he's infinite. That is shirk also. Kama yaliqu bi sha'nihi. He is everywhere the way it is for him. And this question, I got a very good answer from a Christian, not even a Muslim. He was asked, you say this God, where is he? And he gave an answer that he also destroys Christianity. He said, God, Allah, is not confined by time, by space, by matter. So if Allah is not confined by time, space and matter, then Jesus cannot be God. Because Jesus had a body, that was matter. He was confined to a time and space, Jerusalem, Bethlehem. So Jesus cannot be God. He destroys his own belief. And he also said, Allah is like someone has made a computer. The person who has made the computer is not inside the computer, yet he knows everything that is going on in the computer. Whenever there's a fault in the computer, he can immediately detect it. The same way Allah is not in the universe. The universe that he has created, he is not inside. He is watching from a place whereby he sees everything. A very beautiful example. But sad to say, when you don't have iman, you don't even realize that you yourself are on the wrong. Because if Allah cannot be confined to time, matter and space, then it means you cannot give Allah any form, be it human or otherwise. He is there. He created us. You are supposed to worship him. How he came into being is not of any concern to us. It's not of any concern to us. How your parents met and how they became husband and wife, that's not of concern to you. As long as their relation is halal, end of story. As long as they're your parents, even now they believe their relation is haram, but you're still their child, whether you like it or not. Whether they are pious or not, that's not your problem. So the creation of Allah shall not be of concern to us. We should just believe that He is our creator. Definitely there is a creator. Even if, na'udhu billah, we go into evolution and believe that the world came into being. But there was a matter. Specifically, that matter was the beginning. There was an alpha and omega somewhere. So, the Prophet's mission has been left with us. Because we got Islam for free. So what have we given back to Islam? كلكم راع وكلكم مسؤول عن رعيته. Each of you is an overseer, and each of you will be asked about his flock. The basic flock is your family. But you can't guide your family if you yourself don't know about Islam. And Islam is not just a few books read here and there. It's not a bedtime story. Islam is much more than that. I read the ayah, مِنْكُمْ أُمَّةٌ يَأْمُرُونَ بِالْمَعْرُوفِ وَيَنْهَوْنَ الْمُنْكَرِ. Amongst you should be a people who should instruct others to do good and ask them to abstain from evil. This is not only the work of ulama. Remember, the ulama are in the masajid, in the madaris, and in the modern world, in the YouTubes and so forth. But how many people have access to that? Out of the masajid, for example, in Kenya, we have got plus or minus 6,000 masajid. The approximate average people who visit the masjid for a five-time daily basis are 100 people. That means around 600,000 to a million people are practicing Muslims, in Salah only. Yet we have got a population of around 11 million Muslims in Kenya. So we are the other 10 million. This is the adult population that I'm talking about. Well, let's take it from the register of IBC, 5.7 million registered voters. So if a million Muslims are praying, remember, when kids are coming to masjid, where are the other 4.7 million going? Who is going to bring them to the masjid? Who is going to make them realize that they are Muslims? In one of the European countries, the Jama'at of Tabligh went out to do some da'wah. When they went out to do da'wah, they reached a house, they knocked on the door, and they found a certain Abdullah there, or Muhammad, whatever his name was. Assalamu alaikum. Wa alaikum salam. Yes, we have come from such and such a place to come and invite you to the masjid. To do what? Or to listen to the lectures and redefine your Islam. But I'm a Muslim. My name is Abdullah or Muhammad or so forth. Why don't you go to the non-Muslims? He said, okay, you direct us to the non-Muslim. We don't know any non-Muslim. We know you're a Muslim. We came to you. He took them by the hand and took him next door to his neighbor. Knocked on the door. Yes, good morning. Yes, so and so. Yes, I am Bob. Yes, what have you come to do? We have come to preach to you about Islam. What is Islam? What is Islam? Islam is about worshipping Allah, going to the mosque, and so forth and so forth. But my friend here, my next neighbor, is a Muslim also. Yes, he's a Muslim. But what's the difference between him and me? If I take two bottles of wine, he takes three. If I bring in one woman to commit adultery with, he brings two. What's the difference between me and him? Just the name? I will change my name today. If it's the name which is Islam. The Muhammad or the Abdullah, if Allah gives us the opportunity when He comes here in Kenya, I will show you. He said, my whole body shivered and I realized I'm not a Muslim. What he does is what I do. He goes to the bar, I go to the bar. He goes and gets girls and does zina, and I do zina. And I've never noticed that he's been noticing me. You know, when we encourage you that this is a sunnah, Dressing up this way is a sunnah. Having the beard is a sunnah. Covering your head is a sunnah. It's not that it makes you holier than thou. I'm not more pious and righteous than anyone around here. But what it gives me is the opportunity to abstain from sin. You cannot see me in Aba, because I will think 10 times before I go into the Aba, unless now I remove my attire and just go in like that. So this attire or this sunnah abstains me from sin, nothing else. It does not make me holier than thou. It does not make me pious and righteous, no. But it makes me close the door of sin, such that if na'udhu billah, I am tempted to sin, I will think twice. So this jama'ah that goes out there, they are not pious and righteous. In fact, they've got a lot of shortcomings which have been pointed out by critics. But their main agenda is, how can we bring the Muslim into the fold of the masjid? Not to the madrasa, not to any other place, to the masjid. The masjid is a conducive environment. The Muslims are like gemstones, diamonds. But this gemstone, if it is lying out in the gutter, tons of water can pass over that gemstone. It will still be dirty. But that same gemstone, when it is removed from the gutter and you pour just one glass of water on it, it becomes clean. This Muslim is lying in a very dirty environment. There's nothing out there that is not happening. In fact, it has reached to our mobiles, such that I have said it before, that when gambling dens and cinema halls were opened up in Muslim countries, and we questioned it, and they told us, Sheikh, what are you questioning? You have it all on your mobile. Your kids are watching pornographic sites on your mobile in your presence, and you don't even know. So the rot is already there. But still, them legalizing it has made it now more common. So the rot is already there in the environment. We are living in a society whereby sin is a norm of the day. A police officer stops you on the road and openly tells you, in front of your kids and your family, to bribe him. Why? Because it is the norm of the day. There was a time we were at an anti-corruption seminar, and a certain politician, I will not name him, openly said, we are all corrupt. You, Sheikh, tell me, have you never bribed someone? Just because I've bribed someone because of some condition does not make us corrupt. Sometimes you have no option. You are running late, or there's something that you have done, or because it has become the norm. So how are we going to cleanse that sin? Because if you sit in the same environment, nothing will happen. And very few of us have been brought up in the way that we will come to the masjid. And even if we come to the masjid, when we are praying, how many of us are praying sincerely? Out of the million Muslims who are visiting the masjid, out of them, 900,000 are there just physically. To them, salah is just a ritual. Out of the 100,000 that are left, only maybe 10,000 are sincerely there in salah. And out of those 10,000, maybe just 100 might know why they are praying.